Peace and love, ABC family. I need you to stop what you're doing and take a few moments to check out this week's ABC news. I'm coming to you live and direct from the Abyssinian studio. No, seriously. Don't forget, if you or somebody connected to you wants to have your announcements shared during our weekly ABC news segment, please make sure to email us at abcministries1@gmail.com by Tuesday of each week so we can get them on the following weekend. If you or someone you know is looking for gainful employment, if you want a solid job that you can build into a career, please email me at pastorearl25@gmail.com. I need you to put job seeker in the subject line. I'm in partnership with some wonderful community organizations. I would take time to name some, but I don't want to take too long. And I'm connected to some institutions that are looking to hire quality candidates. I made sure that they sent me some of the job descriptions so that we can pass them along to the people in the ABC network. So don't miss out on that opportunity to really uplift you and your family. Don't forget, you looking for a job, you know somebody looking for a job, please send them my way. Put job seeker in the subject line and email me at pastorearl25@gmail.com. This Sunday, we are fully virtual. It's second, fourth, and fifth Sundays. We are fully virtual, so that means we're fully virtual this Sunday. Meet us 10 a.m. on our Facebook page. Everybody, make sure you are tuned in and invite as many people as you possibly can. I'll be continuing in our Black Dollars Matter series about money movement and ministry. I'm not preaching part three of More Than Enough yet. This Sunday, I'm actually preaching a sermon entitled, How Much Did It Cost You? So I want you to read Mark chapter 14 as in its entirety when you get a chance, but I'll be shining some sermonic spotlight on verses 3-6. So don't miss this Sunday as we continue in this pivotal and powerful series, Black Dollars Matter, talking about money, movement, and ministry as part of our fourth phase of our pastoral preaching direction and strategic plan, where we are focusing on the theme of empowerment through philanthropic efforts. Don't you know that our church's 17-year anniversary is coming up in November? Yes, third Sunday in November. That's November 20th. During our 10 a.m. hybrid service, we're going to celebrate 17 years of ministry. We're going to honor what God has been doing in the life of Abyssinian. And in part of the celebration, we're going to do a movie outing. We're going to go as a congregation and watch Wakanda Forever. So please stay tuned for more information on that. We're going to go on Saturday, November 19th. We'll let you know the time. We'll let you know the location. Not only that, Abyssinian is going to donate 10 tickets, no more than two per family. 10 tickets we're going to donate to somebody in the ABC family on a first come, first serve basis. So if you would like to reserve your tickets, please email us starting November 1st. Don't send the email now. It's not November 1st. November 1st, send the email, put movie tickets in the subject line, send it to abcministries1@gmail.com. We'll reserve them as long as we have some of them left. Not only that, this is especially for all of the new members. If you have joined in the last year or two, and especially to those of us who may not be living in Memphis, I want you to make a special trip to Memphis for November 20th for our 17-year church anniversary. All our new members, I want y'all to meet me in the sanctuary at 8:30 a.m. Yes, that's before the 10 o'clock service starts, yes. Meet me for a special new members class. It's gonna be at 8:30 on November 20th before our hybrid service. There is more in store for us regarding our 17-year celebration, so keep your eyes and ears open over the next few weeks because we're gonna make sure we find ways to honor God's grace and movement in our ministry. Early voting is underway. You got a little bit more than a week left. Don't forget, if early voting is going on, you can vote at any open precinct during the open hours. If you need some information, go to upthevote901.com or email us at upthevote901@gmail.com. As a matter of fact, upthevote901 will be hosting a voter empowerment symposium, which is going to focus on criminal justice reform processes. It'll be October 29th, so this upcoming Saturday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., 3890 Mill Branch in the Sanctuary at Abyssinian. If you want more information, go to UpTheVote901 on Facebook, or UpTheVote901 on Instagram, email UpTheVote901@gmail.com. I hope all of you have already connected with us, but I also want you to make sure others are connected with us too. So if you haven't done it yet, you need to text Liberation to 71441. If there are people who are in your network that you know need to connect with us, tell them to text Liberation to 71441. We also have the mobile app. I hope y'all have been checking it out. We update it every week with sermon snippets and the virtual service. Our YouTube stuff is on there. We try to get the announcements. You can access some of the live streams. If you haven't subscribed to our text service yet, you are missing out. We want to make sure that you have all access. Type that in the comment section, all access. So please, please, if you haven't checked it out, put this in your browser right now, abyssinian.mymobisite.us, abyssinian.mymobisite.us, and check it out. Let us know what you think about it. Lastly, since we're in this phase and the sermon series where we're talking about philanthropy and how much black dollars matter, don't forget to be faithful in your giving. Trustee Gail Tyree is going to be reaching out to each of you soon and very soon with a particular pitch that I need you to be aware of and in the know of, and I need you to participate in. All of us do. We need you to participate in every aspect of generosity. That's what you're going to be talking about Sunday. Generosity as it relates to investing our time, talent, and treasure in this ministry where God is moving so mightily. So you know that there are several ways to give. You see it on your screen right now. We have the Cash App, $ABC Ministries, the number one. We have PayPal. You can go to paypal.me/4ABC, or go to PayPal and use the church's email address, abcministries1@gmail.com. Or you can go to Givelify, search Abyssinian Missionary Baptist Church, and look for the guy who looks like me, or go old school snail mail to that P.O. box. Look, brothers, sisters, friends, and kin, we need to make sure we continue to maximize on the movement of God in our midst and in our ministry. So make sure you listen to this in its entirety. Make sure you share this with other people, and I'll be looking for you virtually this Sunday. Meet me at ABC Online. Peace. Hey! Psalmist said, I would bless the Lord at all times, and God's praise shall continuously be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Somebody type that. Magnify the Lord with me, and let us, let us exalt God's name together. Good morning, brothers, sisters, friends, and kin. I am Dr. Earl Fisher. I'm the proud pastor of the Abyssinian Missionary Baptist Church, a church that's affectionately referred to as, type it in the comment section, the blackest church in Memphis and Shelby County, and I'm excited to welcome all of us back to this cyber sanctuary on this fourth Sunday of October. If this is your very first time connecting with the Abyssinian Baptist Church, we want you to let us know. Put something in the comment section, and somebody from our church leadership team or our virtual ambassador is going to connect with you so that we can keep up with you and know the great things that God is doing in your life. But we also want you to be able to keep up with us and know the great things that God is doing in the life of Abyssinian. There are over 4,000 churches in the city of Memphis. There are millions of churches online. We never take it lightly when somebody takes some time out of their day. Whether you are joining us live and direct on this Sunday morning, or if you are watching this later in the week during one of our social media channels, whether it be our Facebook page or our YouTube channel, or maybe you're catching something on Instagram. Either way, do us a favor. Go ahead and share this. Matter of fact, you might have somebody on your heart and on your mind. They need to be connected with us in this sanctuary. They need to magnify the Lord with us today. So won't you at them, put them in the comment section. Again, I'm so glad to be gathering with us. There's so many wonderful things that is happening in the life of Abyssinian, and we are excited to share them with you. If you did not catch the ABC news that preceded this virtual broadcast, make sure you go back and watch it. Matter of fact, you don't even have to wait until the end. If you want to connect with us right now, you can text Liberation to 71441. Text Liberation to 71441. That will connect you with our mobile service. But again, this is the day that our God has made, and we should rejoice and be glad in it. And as such, every time we gather together, we try to remind ourselves of what it is God calls us to do and to be. So we recite our church's mission statement and vision statement. The mission statement lets us know why we exist, and the vision statement lets us know what we should look like as we are living into our mission. Abyssinian family, if you haven't recorded yours yet, we need you to hurry up and do it so that we can feature you just like we're about to feature this ABC member. And I want all of us to recite the mission and vision along with.
Good morning, ABC family. I am Lady Denise Fisher, and I will be sharing our mission and our vision. Read along with me. Our mission. Abyssinian Missionary Baptist Church is a positive, progressive, and prophetic Baptist church where the liberating gospel of Jesus Christ is engaged with head, hand, and heart. Our mission is to be a congregation that actively lives out our faith in efforts to achieve spiritual empowerment, emotional stability, financial responsibility, and physical well-being. Our vision. Our vision is to be a gifted, innovative, inspired, and informed congregational network of friends and kin who live out our faith in such a way that we become one of God's tools to redeem those who are without faith in God, reclaim those who have withdrawn from the Black church, and rejuvenate those who maintain hope in the Black Messiah.
Come on right where you are and run those hearts up. If you have not shared this yet, go ahead and share it. We thank God today for a magnificent and miraculous mission and a victorious vision. Y'all will hear so much more about the mission and the vision of Abyssinian, not just throughout this virtual service, but especially if you connect with us. We are hybrid, which is to say we are in the sanctuary and on the stream on the first and third Sundays, and on the second, fourth, and fifth Sundays, like this is the fourth Sunday, we are gathered in this cyber sanctuary. And so continue to keep your eyes and ears open to us, and we want to give you an opportunity to connect with us as much as possible. And one of the ways you can connect with us is you can contribute to the mission and the vision that you just heard. There are several ways you can give. You don't have to wait to the end of the virtual service. You can use Cash App right now. Use $ABC Ministries, the number one. You can use paypal.me/4ABC. Or you can even use Givelify and look for Abyssinian Missionary Baptist Church. You'll see somebody who looks something like me, about my height, about my complexion, about my weight. Or for the elders or those of us who like to give the old school way, you can email, you can mail it. Look at me, I'm too modern, right? You can mail a check or money order to Abyssinian Baptist Church and use the P.O. box that is on the screen. So those of you who have been following along with us, y'all would know that every year we try to live out through our pastoral preaching direction the strategic plan that we are living into. And our strategic plan tends to have four different phases. And so now we are actually in phase four of our strategic plan. And the theme for that is empowerment through philanthropic efforts. So we've started a sermon series that we've been in. It's entitled Black Dollars Matter. Y'all see the Z? Black Dollars Matter. Hashtag Black Dollars Matter. Well, we're talking about money. We're talking about movement. And we're talking about ministry. I want to thank y'all for the wonderful engagement and feedback that we've gotten over the last several weeks that we've been preaching about Psalm 23 verse 5 with the sermon entitled More Than Enough. Initially, I plan to preach part 3 this week. God says something different, so we'll be preaching part 3 next week. Don't forget, we still fully virtual. It's 5 Sundays in the month of October. So next Sunday, we'll be back virtual, and I'll try to preach part 3 of More Than Enough. But God has put something else on my heart today along the lines of the same theme that we are centered in and the same sermon series. I'll share more about it in just a second. But for right now, I want us to be mindful of all that's happening in our community and our country and our culture. And one of the things that's happening right now, just in case you didn't catch it on the ABC News, one of the things happening right now is we are in the midst of the midterm elections. So early voting is going on right now in Memphis and Shelby County. If you have not voted yet, please make sure that you exercise that fundamental right. All of us who have access, all of us who have the ability, all of us who have the audacity, we need to make sure we are as invested and informed as we possibly can be, and that we are trying to turn out as many people as we can in this election. This is the state and federal general election, so you will be voting for your state representative and your state senator and your governor. You'll be voting for your federal or your congressperson that goes to D.C. You'll be voting on them in terms of our representatives and our congressperson, so, and our senator. So please, brothers, sisters, friends, and Ken, make sure you are doing that. If you need any information that would help you feel more engaged and prepared, don't hesitate to email upthevote901@gmail.com. But in light of that, and in light of so many other things that is happening with our congregation and with our community and with our culture, let me offer up a word of prayer as we prepare our hearts and minds to hear from God and so far as what God has to say in this sermonic moment. So we want to set the sermonic stage in song, but we also want to set the sermonic stage in prayer. So if you're able, won't you bow with me right where you are, close your eyes. Holy God, we thank you for the gift of your Spirit and the ways in which you continue to meet us in all of the ways by which we gather. We thank you for the times that you have saturated the sanctuary with your Spirit. We ask right now that you would continue to saturate this stream with your Spirit. God, we ask that you would call all of us together, call your people together, call your people forth in this moment so that we can hear from you, so that we can feel what you would have us to feel, that we could see what you would have us to see, but most of all, so that we would do and be what you would have us to do and be. God, we thank you for the Abyssinian Baptist Church. We thank you for all that you have called us forth to do and all that you have caused us to do. May we be able to engage in these moments and be made better for. We pray this in the name of that loving, living, and liberating Black Messiah, Jesus the Christ. All of God's people typed and said together, Ashe and Amen. Before we go into this song, I want to give you an opportunity to repeat after me or type these things in the comment section. It's something I'm trying to get us to say every week because I think it grounds us in the substance of Abyssinian. Type this in the comment section. I love God. Come on, I can't see you typing. Everybody, I love God. I love the Black Messiah. Type, I love Black folks. And type, I'm glad to be at the Blackest Church in Memphis in Shelby County. Next thing we'll do is hear a song that'll set the stage for the sermon, and we would that you would flank us and the psalmist with your prayers.
The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbles through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain, some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard. As she poured her love for the Master from her box of alabaster, and I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love all around me. Came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of his touch. So now I'm giving back to him all the praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. And don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. You are there the night Jesus found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around me. The oil.
Consecrate us now to your service, O God, by the power of grace divine. May our soul look up with a steadfast hope. May our will be lost in thine. Let the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart be acceptable in your sight, our God, our strength, and our Redeemer. And all of God's people typed and said together, Ashe and Amen. I want to call our attention to the Gospel according to Mark, the 14th chapter. And I want to shine some sermonic spotlight on verses 3 through 6. Mark chapter 14, verses 3 through 6, reading from, for the most part, the New Revised Standard Version as we continue in the sermon series entitled Black Dollars Matter, Money, Movement, and Ministry. Mark chapter 14, verses 3 through 6. Go something like this. While Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a sister came with an alabaster jar, a very costly, somebody type costly, very costly ointment of nard. Another translation would say spike nard. And she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on Jesus' head. Verse 4 says, but there were some folks who were there, and they got upset. They started complaining and whining, saying that she had wasted this oil. Why was the ointment wasted in this way? Verse 5 says, for this oil or ointment could have been sold on the stock market. Could have been sold to a Fortune 500 company. It could have been invested in designer clothing and fancy cars and more square footage of a home. It could have been sold for more than 300 denarii or a year's wages. And the money could have been given to the folks in South Memphis and North Memphis. They could have gave that money to the poor. They scolded her. But verse 6 says, but Jesus said, leave her alone and stop hating. Church folk don't know when to shout. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for the ministry. She has performed a good service for the movement. She has invested her money in the movement and the ministry. She has performed a good service for me. I want to try to preach for a few moments. Well, maybe I'm just talking again. Y'all know every time I say this, it kind of gets me in trouble. I'm a black preacher, so I call myself just talking. But if some preaching rise up, then preaching do what preaching does. I want to preach or teach using this for a thought. It's a question that I want you to type in the comment section that I want you to write down if you're at home, because I want you to sit with this for the duration of the week. Here's the question. If you're in the sanctuary, I say, turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, how much did it cost you? That's the question. How much did it cost you? I love God. I love the black Messiah. I love black people. I'm glad to be at the blackest church in Memphis and Shelby County. I love God. I love the black Messiah, Jesus. I love black folks. I'm glad to be at the blackest church in Memphis and Shelby County. Yes, these are things that I love. Among them, as I said a moment ago, I love Jesus. I love the black Messiah. Albert Clegg calls him the black Messiah. I love the one who Kelly Brown Douglas calls the black Christ. I love the one who the late great Mack King Carter called the Negro from Nazareth. I love the one who I tend to call every now and then the gangster from Galilee. I love Jesus. And there are many things about the black Messiah that I think I, you, me, we collectively misinterpret or misunderstand about him. I love that Jesus was not some pious priest, but instead was a radical revolutionary religious leader. I love that Jesus was not some right-wing white evangelical, but instead Jesus was a prophetic political leader and righteous religious leader. But what I think we miss maybe the most in our engagement and encounter with Jesus, with the Black Messiah, especially as it relates to Scripture, is that Jesus's attitude, Jesus's actions, and Jesus's articulations are grounded in Jesus's generosity. Type that in the comment section. If you've been paying attention to what I've been preaching as I sat with Psalm 23, verse 5 over the last few weeks and talked about some of the details of that passage, I said that I don't do a lot of talk about tithing per se. I try to cultivate and curate people's generosity, godly generosity. Type that in the comment section, generosity. Matter of fact, I want to see the comment section just flood all throughout this sermon with generosity, because that's really all I'm talking about. I'm saying Jesus's attitude, Jesus's actions, and Jesus's articulations are grounded in his generosity. Simply put, Jesus was, and Jesus is, and I believe Jesus forever will be, one of, if not the most generous human beings of all time. He the GOAT. Generosity. He the GOAT. Jesus has a generous mentality. Jesus' actions, Jesus' attitudes, Jesus' articulations are grounded in his, I'm looking for it in the comment section, generosity. Much of what we find Jesus doing in Scripture is Christologically coded in his desire to give to people who were in need. Let me try it another way. Jesus was not or is not cheap. I can't see nobody typing at me now. Jesus was generous. Jesus freely gave of his time. Jesus freely gave of his talent. Jesus freely gave of his treasure. Most of the time, brothers, sisters, friends, and kin, when we see Jesus in Scripture, we see Jesus giving something to somebody. The Scripture says Jesus gave, type gave. He gave sight to the blind. We would call that free optometry. Scripture says Jesus gave life to lame limbs. We might call that today free medical care. Scripture says Jesus gave hope to the hopeless. We would call that free inspiration. What are you saying, Pastor Earl? I'm saying Jesus's attitude, Jesus's actions, and Jesus's articulations, what he spoke out of his mouth, are grounded in his generosity. Type it in the comment section. So since Jesus is so generous, somebody please explain to me and help me to understand why so many of us who claim to be Jesus' disciples are so stingy. Don't log off, lean in. I'm asking if Jesus' actions, Jesus' attitudes, Jesus' articulations are grounded in his generosity. If one of the fundamental characteristics of Jesus of Nazareth, the Black Messiah, who those of us who subscribe to Christianity claim to be following, if he was so generous, why are so many of us so stingy? Well, if you've been listening to the last few sermons, you might know where I'm trying to anchor this. I believe we are stingy because we've been conditioned by a culture of greed. Y'all remember me talking about the scarcity psychology? When we live in a culture of greed, we get conditioned into believing that there'll never be enough no matter how much we have. So if we simply had a little bit more, we say to ourselves, while lying to ourselves, that if we had more, we would be more generous. For most of us, that's simply not true. For most of us, the more we get, the more we frivolously spend. Have I made it to your address? Can I honk my horn? Most of us, the more we get, the more we frivolously spend. Most of our black institutions, including black churches who are doing the work, including historically black colleges and universities. Pick your black institution. Most of our black institutions are not struggling because black folks collectively don't have any money or resources. No, my brothers, sisters, friends, and kin. Black institutions struggle because most black people are conditioned by a culture of white supremacist greed. Yes, black folks are exploited. Yes, black folks are economically depraved. Yes, black folks are oppressed. And we still, somebody type still, contribute over $1.3 trillion a year to this country's economy. We are just conditioned to contribute to the institutions and the individuals that exploit and oppress us. Yes, we're conditioned to mimic the attitudes and the behaviors of our oppressors. That's why most of us love to wear the latest designer clothes. Most of us love to drive the most fancy cars. Most of us love to live in the white neighborhood. No, don't log off, lean in. We just talking now. Most of us have been conditioned to mimic the attitudes and the behaviors of our oppressor. As such, we take what money and resources we do have and invest them in the continuation of our exploitation and oppression. Preach, Earl Fisher. We give our time, our talent, and our treasure to individuals and to institutions that really don't give a damn about us. I'm talking about ones that refuse to give us even a decent return on our investment. Yet we're skeptical or suspicious of what's going to happen if we give generously to the church. What's going to happen? I ain't going broke giving money. Well, I think about something Sean Carter, that thug theologian, Jay-Z said. He said, Negroes only skeptical when it's their own ish. You bought 9 iPhones, and you know Steve Jobs is rich. Phil Knight worth trillions, and you still bought those kicks. In other words, the culture of greed chokes the life out of our generosity, type generosity. And it promotes the type of thoughtless giving and frivolous spending that makes it nearly impossible for us to ever achieve the financial responsibility and stability we need as a community. This is a sidebar. Here's a resource. Can I give you a quick bibliography? 2 books I feel like everybody should read if you're talking about money and movement and ministry. 1 I mentioned last week. That is Edward Baptist's The Half Has Never Been Told. Another is a book by a brother named Stephen Levitt, and it's entitled Freakonomics. Well, I could think of another 2, maybe Claude Alexander's Black Labor and White Wealth. I could probably go on, but I'm suggesting that there are resources out there for us to get a better understanding of the relationship between money, movement, and ministry. See, this is why I believe Jesus' model and mentality of generosity, type generosity, is so countercultural. It cuts against the grain. The culture that we live in is selfish. The culture that we live in is self-centered. It's so self-centered and selfish that the more we get, the greedier we are prone to become. So every now and then, God has to teach us and maybe even tame us so that we can more authentically embrace God's generosity. It reminds me of a story of a young pastor who had a parishioner who this pastor had aided in the development of the discipline of generosity and stewardship. This pastor had been walking with this individual before they even had gainful employment. In fact, this pastor was partially responsible for putting this particular parishioner on the runway towards gainful employment. The first year, the new member, who did not make much, donated $1,000 to the ministry. Both the pastor and the parishioner celebrated the faithfulness of the discipline and the generosity of this member. It was not about the amount. Are y'all listening to me? It was about the achievement of fulfilling the assignment of being disciplined enough to give generously and continuously and consistently for a whole year. So the new member, who was in his own terms, quote, blessed by God beyond measure because of his faithfulness and fulfillment of the divine assignment, end quote, committed to continuing the practice of giving faithfully and fruitfully and cheerfully, even as God, as we would say in contemporary language, expanded his territory. The practice of generosity, type generosity, planted seeds of discipline in this person such that this person was granted by God to receive exponentially more over the years. And what began as an annual donation of $1,000 became an annual donation of $100,000. Now, before you log off and think that this is some trick or scheme to try to get folks to give, no, hear me out. Because the first thing you should capture is, due to the generosity of this person, God expanded the territory such that the access to the resources multiplied tenfold. Multiplied tenfold. Multiplied tenfold. So what began as an annual donation of $1,000, watch me closely, became an annual donation of $6,000. So the member decided it was time to schedule an appointment with the pastor. The member runs into the pastor's office one Sunday after church and got straight to the point. Said, "Pastor, we need to chat for a minute. I need to talk to you. Can we have a heart-to-heart? You got a few minutes?" Pastor said, "Yeah." The parishioner says, "I need you to do me a favor. See, I need you to talk to God, and I need you to see if God is going to let me out of this covenant and commitment of generosity." Now, Pastor, let's be honest. Come on, Pastor. You know it was okay. It was even reasonable when I was giving $1,000. It was even reasonable when I was giving $10,000. But I know that you know that I ain't supposed to be tithing or giving no $600,000 a year to no black church. Now, here's what I need you to do, Pass. Here's what I need you to do, Doc. Here's what I need you to do, Reverend. I need you to get down on your knees and talk to God and ask God to let me out of this covenant of generosity. Pastor looked the parishioner in the face and said, "Okay." Pastor got down from her desk, went down on her knees and started praying. But the problem was the pastor was praying silently. He was not articulating out loud. Pastor was down on his knees for a while. And since the member didn't know exactly what the pastor was praying, the member got a little bit anxious. Tapped the pastor on the shoulder. Hey, Pastor. Hey, Doc. Hey, Reverend. How's it going down there? Everything okay? You talking to God? Did God agree that I don't have to be so generous? And the pastor replied, Oh, no. I wasn't praying that God would let you out of this covenant or commitment of generosity, because that would be rather ungodly. I was asking God to reduce you back to the place where generosity was more comfortable for you, because you've clearly gotten too greedy. Doors of the church are open. You can come by letter Christian Experience as a candidate for baptism on this stream. Just type it in the comment section. Say, "He talking to me." Because sometimes God has to shrink us to grow us, because generosity is an attitude. It's not a get-rich-quick strategy or technique. That's my primary preaching assignment. Can I tell you why I'm preaching this? It's simple. It ain't even deep or profound this week. I'm preaching this to provide us with some principles to practice holy generosity in every aspect of our lives. It's that simple. Matter of fact, if you don't want to hear it, I hear you. You can go ahead and log off now, because this is what I'm about to be talking about. I'm not talking about tithes and offering. I'm talking about an attitude, an action, and an articulation grounded in holy generosity. I'm preaching to provide us with some principles to practice holy, type this in the comment section, generosity in every aspect of our lives. Because in order to obtain any financial stability or responsibility, we have to overcome human greed with holy generosity. Holy generosity is simple. It's detailed and disciplined giving. It's about knowing how much something costs you.
Because when Jesus gave, Jesus does not give frivolously. Jesus gives with purpose and intention. When Jesus gives, Jesus knows that he has something significant to give. So he chooses to give something costly to people who need it the most. Jesus is what we would call a sacrificial giver. And if you and I want to produce and engage in the type of ministry that Jesus practiced and proclaimed, then sacrificial giving is a non-negotiable. We cannot try to rest in the convenience of cheap Christianity. God, I wish I had time. I ain't gonna hold y'all too long. I'm saying we have to be courageous and compassionate. I'm saying we all collectively have to be willing to give our time, our talent, and our treasure to the places and the people that we see aligned with the movement of God, even when it's costly. I guess I'm saying we need to be like this woman in this text. This woman in this text in Mark chapter 14 is not cheap. Girlfriend is courageous. She is not greedy. Sister girl is, type it in the comment section, generous. The writer of Mark says there was a woman who came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment or oil of nard or spikenard. Watch what she does, y'all. She breaks open the jar or the container and poured the ointment on Jesus's head. This is not a cheap offering. This offering is costly. This is the type of offering that I want to suggest that all of us should be ready, willing, and able to offer up to God. It's not simply expensive, it's costly. Ooh, it's a difference. It's not just expensive, it's costly. It brings me to my first point. Here it is. Costly offerings can't be bound by containers. Just a sneak preview into what part three of More Than Enough will be like. Y'all know we've already talked about God prepares a table before me, even in the presence of our enemies. We already talked some in part two about God anoints my head with oil. Notice we're still talking about oil here. There's some connections if we pay close attention. In part three, I'm going to say something about what it means to have a cup that runneth over. But here in this passage, I'm suggesting costly offerings can't be bound by containers. It's not the alabaster jar that's costly. It's the content in the container. And I don't need any of us to ever confuse a container with its content. This woman had been through enough life experiences that she realized what she had, watch me now, on the inside of her container was too costly to be confined and contained. The Bible says she broke open the jar. She broke open the box. It's a container. A container is a structure that's designed to limit mobility and movement. But the text says she broke open the container. In other words, she made sure she gave the Black Messiah full access to her innermost content. I'm trying to ask somebody on the stream today, if you survey the landscape of your life, can you testify honestly that you have given God access to the innermost content in your life? She's engaging in an expression of generosity because she had been through enough in her life to realize that there's a difference between a cheap gift and a costly gift. That's why the psalmist said, I will not offer to God that which costs me nothing. It's the way that the psalmist is saying what we need to say, which is this. Hear me with your good ear, Abyssinian. I will not offer up to a generous God, some God that has cost me or willing to give me access to everything. I will not offer up to God something that is so cheap, something that is so superficial that it is not costly. I will not offer up to God that which cost me nothing. Why? I'm glad you asked. It does not make good sense to give a God that gave us everything something cheap in return. I guess I could ask if our contributions to the movement and the ministry of God, especially the one that we are connected to, I'm talking to the Abyssinians now, does your contribution and investment in the ministry and the movement of God reflect your generosity? Girlfriend broke the container that was binding up her gift. That's part of what I'm trying to do in this preaching moment homiletically. I'm trying to get some of us so confident in the ways and the will of God that we would break down any container that is binding up our gift, whether it's a container of trauma, a container of anxiety, a container of oppression, a container of fear, a container of religion, a container of fill in the blank. She offers to God the full range of content. This type of holy generosity makes good sense. Because whatever we have because God has provided. Ooh, if y'all was in the sanctuary, I might make a run right there. That's what the songwriter said in that song that we love to sing. It's one of the great hymns of the church. It's called Great is Thy Faithfulness, and it's borrowing from Scripture when it says, all that I have needed, yes, Lord, God's hands have provided. In other words, costly gifts can't be contained. Costly offerings not only can't be contained, here's the second thing I need us to capture today. Costly offerings have to be concentrated and conferred upon the Christ. Christ is the anointed one. I'm still talking about oil. Christ is the black Messiah, Messiah in Hebrew, the anointed one. And I'm suggesting our costly offerings, the things we had to work the hardest to obtain and to maintain, have to be concentrated and conferred to the Christ. It's not only what she did with the container that blesses me. It's the nature of the content itself. Help me, Holy Ghost. The scripture says inside the alabaster box was a costly ointment of nard. Commentators suggest that nard is short for spikenard. Spikenard is, watch this, imported oil that comes from the spiked root of an Indian or African nard plant. Teach Earl Fisher. This means when the plant is being uprooted, the person pulling up the plant has to make sure that the oil runs properly, because the person who is pulling up the plant runs the risk of being stuck or injured by the spike. I'm gonna make it plain in a second. Stick with me, I'm going somewhere. In other words, this content is costly because somebody takes a risk to retrieve it. And I'm talking to some of us on the stream right now. If you're anything like me, you understand that there were certain seasons and spaces in your life where the struggle was so strong that you had to handle every aspect of your life with care, all of your labor and all of your relationships and your mind and your peace and your pocketbook. Preach, Earl Fisher. And you had to handle it with care because you understood one wrong move and you'd mess around and get injured by the spike of oppression. Who am I preaching to? And I'm suggesting that when you've been through those spaces and those seasons, you understand how delicate you have to handle God's divinity in your life. So you make sure whatever you offer to God, you offer up intentionally. In other words, you concentrate and confer your costly offering onto the Christ. Chances are, girlfriend is not the one that took the risk to retrieve the oil herself. She just took a risk to obtain it. Y'all missing it. In other words, somebody else had already done some of the labor and risked some of the injury to get the oil in the container in the first place. Girlfriend takes a risk to go and obtain it, but she's obtaining something that somebody had already taken a risk to make accessible. I'm talking about our ancestors, because they already took a risk for many of us to get access to the resources that we have right now. What made this content so costly was the process of retrieving and obtaining that involved more than one person. This is why you keep hearing me say, no matter what it is that we have, you did not get by yourself. I don't care how hard you worked for it, and we all should be willing to work hard. The reality is we have access to what we have access to because we have elders and ancestors that opened up the door and shattered the glass ceiling before we ever stepped up on the scene. That's why we should never be so selfish and self-centered to think that the things we have belong to us and us alone. In other words, there's an African principle called Mbangi. Mbangi, M-B-O-N-G-I. Mbangi literally means we gather together and learn of each other. One of the ways to describe it is with this phrase: what you think belongs to you, but what you say belongs to us. I can't see nobody typing at me. In other words, whatever is happening internally belongs to you alone. But as soon as it becomes an outward expression, it belongs to the entire community. Why? Because we know none of us get here by ourselves, and everything that we have, God has provided, and God didn't provide it just for us alone. Somebody else took the risk for us to retrieve it. We have to take the risk to obtain it. What made the content so costly was that process of retrieving and obtaining that involves more than one person. And too many of us end up treating things cheaply because we refuse to acknowledge that what we have obtained, we did not obtain without the help of other people. Somebody educated you. Somebody nursed you. Somebody trained you. Or, as our elders and ancestors would say, somebody prayed for me. Had me on their mind, took the time to pray for me. And I'm so glad they prayed that I decided to handle those things that are most intimate and costly to me. I decided to handle it by giving it over to Jesus and stop worrying about it. See, when we get stuff too quickly, or when we get stuff and refuse to acknowledge the process of sacrifice and struggle that goes along with getting the things that have value, we end up being prone to waste our gifts or even spill our offerings. I know folk in Abyssinia who get all manner of gift. I'm not just talking about economic gift. I'm talking about gifts of creativity, gifts of administration, gifts of service, gifts of insight, gifts of all manner of gifts, but we don't want to share them freely. We don't want to confer them on the Christ because there's no price tag directly associated with it. I wish I had time. Y'all lucky I'm running out of time here, or else I stay right there, but y'all know what I'm talking about. I ain't saying no names. I ain't looking at no, well, I'm looking at everybody, and you know what I'm talking about. So many of us waste our gifts or spill our offerings on things and people and institutions and organizations and activities that don't benefit us. How much did it cost you? This woman came to a place where she understood how much it cost her. She understood the necessity of concentrating her contribution. She would not just give it anywhere or to anybody. Who am I preaching to now? She would not just give it anywhere to anybody. We ought not just give it anywhere to anybody. I can't see nobody typing at me. She offered the content to a specific person in a specific way. Notice she did not frivolously give this expensive gift away. Maybe she had grown tired of giving her gifts to folks who could not appreciate them. Maybe we should grow tired of, as the scripture would say, casting our pearls to swine. Maybe we should grow tired of get rich quick schemes. Maybe we should grow tired of thinking all we got to do is start with $20 and put it in. No, maybe we should grow tired of thinking we're going to end up going viral and become some YouTube or Instagram or Facebook or social media sensation, and then they're going to pay us for our content. She broke open the container. She concentrated the costly offering on the head of the Holy One. Notice, y'all, and I'm about done. Her oil did not spill. Church folk don't know when to shout. She did not waste this on Jesus. This ain't some accident. This ain't some coincidence or happenstance. This is pre-planned. She was in her house organizing her oil. In a container, she said to herself, when, help me, Holy Ghost, when I get into the presence of the Holy One, I am going to concentrate this oil. It ain't going to leak on him. It ain't going to spill on him. I'm not going to waste it on him. I'm going to pour it. She concentrated her costly offering onto the one by which she feels had made her able to do what she was doing. And when she did that, she also conferred the gift to the Christ. I'm about done. But to confer something means to give it to the one who's been found worthy of the gift. Are y'all listening to me? Conferring is what they do when you have earned a degree. I need your help to preach. The authorized administrator signs and seals and delivers to the individual a symbol that verifies that this person, based upon past performances, can be entrusted with certain rights and privileges and responsibilities. I feel something in my shashabo ibo shata. When we confer something to someone, we literally transfer power into their hands. That's what girlfriend did. She conferred her gift to him. She concentrated her costly gift onto the head of the one who had some past performances in her life, and she deemed it worthy. And I wonder if there's anybody on the stream this Sunday morning, and you can look back over the landscape of your life and testify, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I don't know where I would be. Well, I got a recommendation for you this Sunday. You ought to put some oil on God's head, and you ought to put your life in God's hands. She concentrated and conferred her costly gift onto Christ. That's what we ought to do. What is your most costly gift? How much did it cost you? What did God have to bring you through in order for you to get access to the privileges and the rights and the responsibilities appertaining thereto? And what is it that you have given back to God to show God how much you thank God? I'm done. Let me do this last thing. I'm not trying to do a part two of this. I'll be out of your way. I won't even raise my voice if God says the same. We have to recognize that costly gifts cannot be contained. We have to realize that we need to concentrate and confer our gifts to God. God gave them anyway. You ought to ensure that God gets access to somebody else because of your generosity. Oh, I wish I had time. I'm going to just say that one more time. All of us have a divine responsibility to make sure somebody else gets access to God based upon our generosity. Here's the last thing. I need y'all to be clear about something. Costly gifts will cause confusion. I can't see nobody typing at me now. Hey, this probably only for the few of us who are actually going to be committed to ensuring that we give generously so that other people can get access to the same God that we testify about. We need to know costly gifts can cause confusion. I'm in Bible country. The text says, but there were some folk in Jesus' presence who started murmuring and snickering and gossiping and arguing. Why she waste that oil like that? Why is she doing that? With that oil, you know, You know what they could have done with that? Had she put it in a savings account? You know what she could have done with that? Has she invested it in the stock market? You know what she could have done with that? If she would have gave it over to the philanthropist and the hedge fund managers, you know what she would have done with that? Why she wasted? She could have sold it. She could have got a whole lot of money for it, and she could have gave it to the folk in South Memphis or East Memphis or North Memphis, and they scolded her. And I just need to take a sidebar and try to capture something I heard Reverend soon-to-be Dr. Reginald Sharp say in a sermon snippet that I saw on social media. He said it, and I wish I had came up with it myself. It's so good. He said, yeah, but at the end of the day, it ain't your oil. In other words, you get to decide what you gonna do with your oil, but stop being so caught up and confused about what somebody else does with their oil. It ain't your oil. When it's your oil, you decide who to give it to. When it's your oil, you decide where it goes. But the fact of the matter is, it ain't your oil. Girlfriend had been intentional and thoughtful about what to give and who to give it to, and some of her own people. Matter of fact, some scholars suggest that there are some people there who may have been her clients. Some suggest she may have had a job as a sex worker, and some of the people up in there had contributed to her funds. I can't see nobody typing at me. And now they sit up there being all hypercritical and trying to scold her under their breath about what she doing with money that they invested in. Now it's a ball of confusion. It's a ball of confusion. And I want to suggest on my way to my seat that they are confused because cheap folks are always confused by other folks' costly offerings. Good evening, Abyssinian. May the Lord bless you real good. But don't you be led astray by their claims to the poor. It's a whole lot of folk making it seem like they give a damn about the poor, and they really don't. The fact is, if they wanted to help the poor, as one scholar says, they could have helped them at any time. If our government really cared about the poor, maybe we would be sending money to poor communities like Flint and Jackson and making sure they got water to drink instead of sending billions of dollars overseas to fight a war between Ukraine and Russia. I can't see nobody typing at me. Maybe if our government really cared about the poor, here in Memphis, we would actually have a shelter to house those experiencing homelessness instead of sitting up here arguing about how many millions of dollars we gonna invest in a soccer stadium. Folks are more concerned with who the offering is being given to than how much it costs. I'm done. I'm sorry. I ain't mean to raise my voice right there, but I felt it. They wanted to have control over the offering, so they used it so that they could use it for their own greedy gain. That's why some folks running for office. They so confused because she didn't give her offering to Simon, the owner of the house. She gave it over to Jesus. And she stopped worrying about it. I'm reluctant to report today, but I'm done. That this is often the case when we surrender our gifts to God. Folks are going to be confused. It's folks wondering, Pastor Earl, why are you not coaching basketball? Because my gift was called to the ministry. Somebody going to ask you, why are you doing what you're doing? Why are you spending all that time at that church? Why are you donating what you're donating to that ministry? And it's going to be confusing to them. They're going to chastise you. They might even rebuke you. But what really throws these folks for a loop is the fact that the offering she gave her access to liberation, even though she had never received an invitation. Yep. Yeah. Her offering put her in a space to get direct access to the liberation, even though as a woman, she had never received the invitation. This is for all of us who feel like we gotta wait for somebody to give us an okay so we can be great. This is for all of us who have been feeling that the gifts that God has given us are stirring up on the inside, and we sitting there waiting for clearance or waiting for affirmation. Who am I preaching to? Somebody waiting on a degree, waiting on the election result. And you've been wanting to stand up and speak up. You've been looking around to see if it might offend somebody and see who's getting all nervous and antsy. Well, I dare us to take a page out of this woman's playbook. She did not get an invitation to the party. She just showed up. She heard that Jesus was in town. So she went to Simon's house. She did not wait until somebody gave her access. She decided that since Jesus was in the neighborhood, she would take advantage of his presence, even if nobody gave her permission. And the good news is, Abyssinian, even though they chastised her, Jesus covered her. When they tried to rebuke her, Jesus redeemed her. Jesus said, leave her alone. She's doing a good service for me. Jesus says she don't need your affirmation because she has mine. She doesn't need your pat on the back because she has my protection. And I just pulled up to this stream and I'm about to log off to testify and tell somebody under the sound of my voice, stop waiting around. Stop looking around, because cheap folks will never understand how much pain this cost you. They'll never understand how much you had to go through to get where you are in God. So let them fuss, let them cuss, let them complain, let them whine, let them rise up. But the Bible says when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard. And I stopped by to tell somebody, you never need the oppressors or the enemy's permission to live out your passion. You never need the enemy's invitation to go get your liberation. Good night, sweet children. May the Lord bless you real good. I'm trying to log off, but I feel something in my shasha bowl. I'm reminded of that classic story that Shirley Caesar once told about a guy named Shouting John. There was a new church being built in Shouting John's town, and this dignified and aristocratic church didn't believe in shouting or dancing. They didn't believe in speaking in tongues. And when they opened the doors of that church, John joined that church, and everybody got disturbed because John was dancing all around the church. Who am I preaching to? When they held his hands, his legs start going. When they tried to bind up his legs, then his mouth kept moving, because somebody said, it's just like fire shut up in my bones. Well, the board had a meeting about old Shouting John, and they said, we got to do something about Shouting John. Something's wrong with that brother. Doesn't he know that we got dignitaries in our church? Doesn't he know that we have elected officials in our congregation? Doesn't he know that we don't act like that up in our church? Let's go see about Shouting John. And they drove out to John's territory. And as they were driving their fine cars, there was this 86-year-old man plowing behind an old beat-up mule. They came up and spoke. And they said to John, if you can't stop dancing, if you can't stop shouting, then we're going to have to put you out of our church. Well, John said, well, put me out then, because I can't hold my peace. Did you see the land that you drove up on? God gave me that land. It did not get foreclosed on. And my background ain't squeaky clean, but not one time have I been to the courthouse. Do you see that family in there? These are all my children, and that's my beautiful wife of 56 years, and not one time in 56 years have I had to go to the cemetery and bury any of them. But here y'all are coming to my territory, out here in my yard, by my house, with my family, and in front of my God, telling me not to dance in your little funky church. Well, if you don't want me to dance in your church, hold my mule and I'll shout right now. And I'm trying to log off, but my soul is happy. Yes, Lord, because that's what I want to leave you with. When you know what you've been through and you know what it costs you, you don't have to wait till the battle is over. You can shout right now. You know, generosity will put you in a position of gratitude. I'm done. Oh, Lord, I'm done. Generosity will put you in a position of gratitude such that you can't hold your peace because you realize exactly how gracious and generous God has been to you. So you don't care when other folks get confused because you're too busy being grateful. That's what I want to see manifest in all of us. That's what happens when we take a posture and a position of gratitude and generosity. You end up being a living testimony to the graciousness and the gift of God. How much did it cost you? How much did that joy cost you? How much did that peace cost you? How much did that good night's sleep cost you? How much did that marriage and relationship cost you? How much did that educational achievement cost you? How much did that entrepreneurship journey cost you? How much did that journey with Jesus cost you? I believe it cost us a lot. So much so that we should be willing to give such that somebody else gets access to God in the same way. You shouldn't be able to hold your peace as good as God has been to all of us. This is the word of God is given to the people of God. It's all for the glory of God. Here's what I ask that we do in response. A few things. One, prepare your most generous gift. It might be monetary, it might be manifest in some other way, but prepare your most generous gift. And I want you to grant it to God through where you see God moving in ministry. If you've been blessed by Abyssinian, there's some other people who should be blessed because of you. Prepare your most generous gift. Here's the other thing I want you to do. I want you to take a survey because we're about to extend this invitation. The invitation is threefold. And I want you to survey where you are. The first invitation is an invitation to confess that you're not in right relationship with God, but you want to be. So it's connect. We want you to connect with God through the Black Messiah, not through white Jesus. There's a difference. We want you to connect with God through the Black Messiah. And we want you to, this is the second invitation, to commit on the journey with Jesus, the Black Messiah. Commit to spiritual maturity. Commit to growing and developing in the faith. And we believe that would cause you to collaborate. Collaborate with the Blackest Church in Memphis and Shelby County. It means to not just receive what we have to offer in ministry. It means to contribute. It means to be generous in what you give to this ministry. So wherever you are, matter of fact, if you at the commit stage, type commit. If you at the connect stage, type connect. If you at the collaboration phase, type collaboration. If you haven't already, text Liberation to 71441. Let's make sure we are connected and committed and collaborating. Maybe you need a moment to give financially. This would be the time. We've said it before. It's on your screen now. There are several ways to give. You can give Cash App. You can give PayPal. You can give Givelify. You can give snail mail. I want to see what Abyssinian is going to become when all of us adopt holy generosity. I'm not talking to you about tithes and offering. I'm talking to you about being generous and gracious. I leave you with these words of benediction, trusting that God's word does not go forth and come back void. I trust that the grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of God stands forever. I trust that you know how best to respond to what God has said and shared in this space today. So, beloved, I want you to go. And may the spirit of our sovereign Savior, Saturate the seeds of salvation that have been sown in our life today. I want you to be touched by a sincere spirit and kept in holy care until the wings of God's love and mercy guide us all to our divine destination. Beloved, I want you to dance with divinity and groove in the gospel, with the fierce recklessness to love all things holy, even if you think it's profane, because God loves us even when we don't like it. Jesus loves us even when we don't deserve it. I love you. Ain't much you can do to stop it, so I want you to go. Love mercy. Live justly. Walk humbly with our God till we meet again, in the name of our loving, living, and liberating Black Messiah, Jesus the Christ. All of God's people said together, Ashe and amen.